But you really do need sort of Jedi powers in order to know, like, okay, so sometimes the floor opens underneath you, and what do you do next? So this is from episode 6, Return of the Jedi.
All right.
Opening sequence of scenes, which really, like, you know, lasts like the first quarter of the movie, is Han Solo is a piece of artwork up on Jabba the Hutt's wall. And the whole gang is coming in to rescue and to try and extract him from there. And in that scene, we see that they use, there are different ways, different approaches that they try to get him out of there. There's a rescue mission that's launched, and there's also a negotiation effort.
Greetings, Exalted One. Allow me to introduce myself. I am Luke Skywalker, Jedi Knight and friend to Captain Solo. I know that you are powerful, Mighty Jabba, and that your anger with Solo must be equally powerful. I seek an audience with your greatness to bargain for Solo's life. With your wisdom, I'm sure that we can work out an arrangement which will be mutually beneficial and enable us to avoid any unpleasant confrontation. As a token of my goodwill, I present to you a gift. These two droids.
This can't be. R2, you're playing the wrong message.
It's like straight out of the book of interest-based negotiation. He straight out says, I'm sure that with your wisdom,
I'm sure that
we can find an outcome that will be of mutual benefit. Well, that gambit didn't bring them close to resolution.
We're doomed.
Interestingly, this scene is followed immediately by a scene showing a very different type of negotiation. A negotiation that's straight out of the books on positional bargaining, complete with highballing, lowballing, counter offers, thermal detonators, you name it.
50,000,
no less.
The Mighty Jabba asks why he must pay 50,000.
Yato.
Because he's holding a thermal detonator.
Unitan 35, 13, T-Mai 9.
Jabba offers a sum of 35. And I do suggest you take it.
Yato-cha.
He agrees!
It's a situation where the odds are really stacked against Luke. He's going into Jabba's territory. Jabba's got all his folks there. They all have a bunch of weaponry. There's a lot of firepower on Jabba's side. Jabba is resistant to mind tricks. So he's not going to be easy to convince to let his friends go. And certainly Luke is in a situation that has been a weakness of his before, which is that he is trying to rescue his friends. And yet he pulls it off. And I think a lot of it comes from this recognition that he couldn't do it alone. He had to have people who were helping, and he had to put those people into place. He couldn't just sort of storm Jabba's palace with a small team. He needed to put these folks into place early, that Lando has been there for a while. You know, we see R2 and C-3PO being given as gifts. Chewie is a prisoner. Leia also becomes a prisoner, but not before she's able to free Han from the carbonite.
So let me ask you, Jen, was this all just pre-work to this confrontation? Or was this a real negotiation situation that in the end sort of devolved into a confrontation?
You can see him sort of having this sort of tiered plan where he, you know, first tries for the trade. And then there's this sort of slight escalation to you can profit from it or die, you know, the threat there. When those two things don't work, that's when all that pre-work really comes in handy, because now, you know, if he expected that Jabba wouldn't negotiate, you know, he needed to have a plan in place for getting what he wanted. But I think he left the door open at the beginning, just like a good Jedi.
You will bring Captain Solo and the Wookiee to me. Nevertheless, I'm taking Captain Solo and his friends. You can either profit by this or be destroyed.
Because that, oh Jedi, your Anya wish that shall be true.
The situation got heated really, really quickly. And mm-hmm. he jumped to that, to the threat of destroying Jabba really quickly for someone who's come to talk peace.
Yeah, I have this weapon. I'm dying to use it. Let's talk peace so I can pull out my weapon.
Right. Remember, Luke didn't ask for anything in his opening gambit. He sent the droids in and he didn't send them in with an opening offer. All he did was he framed, I want to have a bargaining session in which we will discuss Solo's fate. That's all he, that's how he framed his ask. Mm. And when he came into Jabba's palace, he was not admitted. He had the Jedi mind trick there. He saw how Jabba reacted to his being there. And Jabba swept Bib Fortuna aside and told him, it's a Jedi mind trick and I told you not to admit him. So he shifted to a power mode very quickly.
And he's what Princess Leia is right there. I mean, so if she had not been, I think, in her, you know, amazing bikini, you know, obviously in chains right in front of Luke's face, maybe he doesn't shift quite as quickly.
Well, so let's flip that script though. What if Jabba had asked him? You know, he walked in and he said, ah, Skywalker, you know, and then spoken some more Huttese and he said, you know, I'll never let you take Solo off my favorite piece of artwork off the wall. So what do you want? And they would have started, a high opening position. And they would have started speaking. Would Luke have then been able to shift as naturally back into diplomacy, given that his mind was set on aggressive negotiation?
We actually don't have a whole lot of examples of Luke doing diplomacy. You know, we don't really know that he was any good at that at all. Whereas we have a lot of examples of other Jedi negotiating, behaving as diplomats. I mean, it's hard to know with Luke what kind of where his head was with respect to that.
His High Exaltedness, the great Jabba the Hutt, has decreed that you are to be terminated immediately.
Good, I hate long waits.
You will therefore be taken to the Dune Sea and cast to the pit of Carcoon, the nesting place of the all-powerful Sarlacc.
Doesn't sound so bad.
As you are slowly digested over 1,000 years.
Second thought, let's pass on that, huh?
You should have bargained, Jabba.
You know, it's hard to train into flexibility.
Yeah,
before
it really
you train
is.
Into what the thing is. So yeah. some people have written, Monte Cristo talks often about preparing for the unexpected, really as most of what you can prepare for or plan for in the first place is just to know how to flow with the unexpected. But you really do need sort of Jedi powers in order to know, like, okay, so sometimes the floor opens underneath you and what do you do next?
Victims of the almighty Sarlacc, His Excellency hopes that you will die honorably. But should any of you wish to beg for mercy, the great Jabba the Hutt will now listen to your pleas.
You tell that slimy piece of worm-ridden filth to get no such pleasure from us, right?
Jabba, this is your last chance. Free us or die.
Okay, let's talk about threats. One thing that drives me so crazy about these movies is the main character, and I'm sure this is a narrative device, the main character always makes a threat, like, do what I want or you'll die, whatever, when they're at their weakest position. They know they're in a strong position, but the counterpart does not believe them that they're in a strong position. And so they never accept the bargain because the threat is always made at an incredibly crazy, implausible time.
Narratively speaking, part of the reason they do that is to sort of shield the main character from I don't know, having done something kind of immoral or violent, you know, that they gave, they created this opportunity for the bad guy to have an out. You know, the bad guy really brought it on himself because he knew, he'd been informed of what could happen.
If we told this scene from Jabba the Hutt's perspective,
great,
what would it be?
I'm trying to enjoy my artwork. And these crazies, they start flinging things at me, right? I mean, first, this guy sends me a robot. It's like, from his point of view, it's like somebody walks into your front door and says, I want to buy your house. Right? You say, like, I'm living here, dude. Like, no, I want to buy, I'm going to buy your house. You know, you're powerful and I'm powerful. I'm sure we'll come to something. And the house isn't for sale. Right?
I think it makes Jabba seem a little bit too much like an innocent purchaser for value. I mean, he's definitely knows that this person that he's paid a bounty hunter to go and fetch has friends, has connections, has relationships. Because I feel like he's acting in a very spiteful manner, and not really one that suits his own interests.
When Jabba received that first message from Luke, I think Jabba had every reason to suspect that something is off here. Mm-hmm. Jedi's haven't been seen for a gazillion years. Bib Fortuna whispered in his ear, he's no Jedi. So he might have good reason to instantly assume that from the very first line that Luke said, I am Jedi Master Luke Skywalker, that this is all some sort of a hoax. And this is all some sort of a fib. So he's willing to take the droids and sort of file them away. Okay, I've gotten two droids for nothing. But right from the very next actions, all of his suspicions about Luke and his intentions are reinforced because Luke engages in trust-breaking behavior. But also the last time he sort of gave in to sentiment and not to violence was in his negotiation in the first movie in episode 4, an omitted scene that was later restored in the when he meets Solo and he lets Solo go, and he says, you're gonna have to pay me 20% more of what you owe me. And Solo says, you know, don't go too far, Jabba, I'll pay you 15 or something like that. And Jabba accepts it. And Solo tells him, you're a wonderful human being. So there's that kind of warmth and flattery. He calls Solo, my boy, I think, in that scene. And so there's flattery and there's no violence, or sort of they've all lowered their weapons by that point. There are guards. But the last time he sort of gave into that non-physical threat right now, Solo skipped out on him from his point of view.